Okay, so The Last of Us decided that we all needed to have an emotional breakdown, and I would really like to discuss Bill, Frank, and the huge difference between the video game and the HBO Max series. Hey guys, I'm McGann. This is still the Fangirl, and I was not prepared for the emotional slap that came with episode 3 of The Last of Us. And don't worry, I won't be talking about any in-game spoilers past Bill, so non-gamers can enjoy this video too. Now, if you've somehow been under a rock for the last few months, HBO Max has taken the mega popular Naughty Dog game, The Last of Us, and turned it into one of the most hyped shows in recent years. Seriously, everyone is going on nonstop about how good this series is and how it's destined to be a top-rated show. And yeah, it's good. And I have really appreciated that there have been various changes to the story that make it different for the avid gamer fans. But sometimes the story gets nudged around a little too much for my taste. Like how they're referencing that all the cordyceps are a hive mind system, which in turn kind of implies that they're gonna find a queen bee of the cordyceps, and they're gonna have to thwart her to end the risk of infections in humans. If that's where things go, I think it would destroy the poignancy of the original storyline. But speaking of poignant, how about Bill and Frank in episode 3? Oh my gosh, I was not ready to be hysterically sobbing at a private wedding ceremony like that. I don't even cry at real weddings. It's like, what even is life anymore? There is no true love left for the rest of us. Bill and Frank own it all. For anyone who hasn't seen it, the TV show presents us with Bill, this doomsday prepper, and he's escaped being rounded up by the government to go live in a quarantine zone, so Bill just takes over a little abandoned city instead. Then we have Frank, who is this starry-eyed, romantic dreamer type. Frank actually feels a little bit manipulative at first, like, hey, give me food, let's hop in bed together, I'm gonna stay here for a few days. You know, these were all things that primarily benefited Frank. But as the years progress, Frank really seems to be a dedicated, loving partner. And to be fair, so does Bill, even though he's a lot more gruff and he doesn't externalize his emotions as much as Frank. And if you are unfamiliar with the game, Bill and Frank are legit characters, except we never see Frank. We do find a letter that he wrote to Bill, but it is not the same vibe as his live-action counterpart. To quote, well, Bill, not even dear Bill, just well, Bill, I doubt you'd ever find this note because you were too scared to ever make it to this part of town. But if for some reason you did, I want you to know I hated your guts. I grew tired of this shitty town and of your set in your ways attitude. I wanted more from life than this, and you could never get that. And that stupid battery you kept moaning about, I got it. But I guess you were right. Trying to leave this town will kill me. Still better than spending another day with you. Good luck, Frank. Which, essentially, it sounds like Frank was mad and took off for greener pastures, and that can be a pretty bad decision during the zombie apocalypse, and I get the impression that Frank has gotten bit. So his last major action before turning into a mindless mushroom man was to write Bill a letter expressing all of his discontent. Whew, can you even imagine the level of resentment that had to be growing for that to be somebody's last words? And I'm not even sure if Joel or Ellie ever directly tells Bill about finding this letter. But video game Bill is this Nick Offerman-looking man who seems embittered that Frank is gone now. But their actual relationship is barely even hinted at. It's like Bill is too upset and hurt to talk about Frank, so we get this angry, burly attitude that Frank did Bill wrong, but we really don't know the details. Between Bill's behavior and the tone of Frank's letter, a lot of us players didn't realize that Bill and Frank were a romantic couple until Ellie uncovers Bill's magazines that feature nude men. Then we collectively went, oh. But without that magazine detail, Bill and Frank felt like a grumpy old men scenario where these two guys who couldn't stand each other just happened to live in the same neighborhood and work to make each other nuts all the time. Also, before the comments explode about heteronormative lenses, this game released a decade ago, so the entire country was still wearing those lenses in the media. It was considered very brazen to have openly gay characters at this point. So yeah, a lot of us did not see Frank's letter as a scorned lover's note. Now, obviously, if you watched episode 3 of The Last of Us, Bill and Frank present a much different relationship, and part of that is due to acceptance and tolerance evolving over recent years. Now, Bill is alive and crotchety when we find him in the game, so, you know, the murder-suicide pact did not take place, but oh my gosh, can we compare the notes? Okay, there's actually not a good picture of Bill's full note to Joel, but Bill basically says, "Hey Joel, you'll probably be the only person to find this letter. You can go ahead and have my car. Here's the password." And Frank was my life. He was my love. He was my purpose. And it's a really sweet letter of how Bill feels good about his decision to pass away with Frank and for Joel not to feel bad for him. And he mentions in that letter for Joel to protect Tess, who has already been infected and she has blown herself up. And I do want to pause here and say that it's interesting to see Bill's live action letter get read, because we see Joel have such a stoic expression, but there is so much going on behind his eyes. Of course, we already know that Joel just lost Tess in episode 2, and even though they seem to have an undefined relationship, Joel really cared for Tess, and they appeared to be something in the ballpark of an unmarried married couple, and Joel just could not protect her in the end. And that's the loss we can empathize with right now because it's fresh, but also consider that Joel lost his brother Tommy to the Fireflies, and now Joel doesn't know if Tommy is okay. So he's stressing about not being able to protect his brother either. Same issue with his daughter Sarah, who was injured and died due to the military panicking about the cordyceps outbreak. So Joel has lost everyone close to him at this point. And let's even take another step back. Joel's wife had to have also passed away at some point before the outbreak. And I insist that his wife is no longer among the living, because Joel appeared to have full custody of Sarah, which would be very unusual with his hectic late-night work schedule. You know, the court's like a consistent household where the parents are going to be home every evening. And Sarah never makes mention of her mother during the outbreak. There's no line of, "We have to go get Mom," or "Do you think Mom is okay in New Jersey?" The woman does not exist, and the only logical rationale is that she wasn't living before the outbreak started. And that not only tells us why Joel is so cold and distant with Ellie, because Joel has developed a classic avoidant attachment style after all of his losses, but it also tells us why Joel and Tess were never a super official thing. Joel's departed wife was the true love of his life, and he lost her, so he can't just go and replace her by marrying someone else or having an advertised relationship with another person. That would dishonor his late wife's memory. So Joel is not doing well in the mental health department, but by having all of these people that he loves basically slip through his fingers, that is going to motivate what Joel does by the end of the season. So pay close attention to how Joel and Ellie's relationship develop from this point on. But circling back to Bill and Frank again, I'm not sure how I feel about this big story change. Ultimately, Joel and Ellie still get a vehicle, so nothing significant in the plot is altered. But in a series that is already so heavy and sad, I'm not sure if I'm okay with purposefully making things heavier and sadder. It would be one thing if Bill and Frank were still surviving, but to see their entire relationship and the end of their lives just railroad the series and happen on screen like that, it makes for too much of an emotional overload. It takes me back to being an unsuspecting 7th grader playing Final Fantasy VII, and Sephiroth just swords Aerith as I show up to save her. I do not like rolling on the floor crying as a form of entertainment. And as much as I thought that relationship between Bill and Frank was very sweet, I am dissatisfied that the series didn't hint to any of this in the trailers. I could have used a heads up. The romance and pills are story-stopping and overly gratuitous, and I guess I won't have a full gauge on my opinion until we see how other upcoming elements of the show play out. Like, Bill and Frank are not recurring characters in the game or show, so why was so much effort thrown into making us emotionally invest in Bill and Frank? It seems overdone at this point. Future episodes might balance it out, though. We'll see as they air. But I did see that episode 3 gave the Last of Us something like a 37% boost in viewership. So I'm curious what your feelings are in this episode and what you think about the series in general. Leave me a comment and let me know.
I might be overthinking it, but that's literally my job. I just want a happy ending in the apocalypse. Is that too much to ask for?
Well, family members, we're almost done, but I want to invite you to hang out with me in some other places. I'm on Twitter and Instagram as my own personal self, and I have a Facebook page too, but I mostly just post photos over there. And sometimes people say, hey, McGann, I want to mail you something. How do I do that? Easy. Just click the About tab on my channel page, and my most current P.O. Box info will be right there. I also run another channel, The Fanily. It's really a hodgepodge channel where we might post anything. Oh yeah, and I also sell shirts and stickers and stuff with the Fanily and the Fangirl logos. If that is your cup of tea, I have a link in every description of every video. Finally, if you want to help out the Fangirl channel and make sure I'm putting out video essays for years to come, the best way you can help is by subscribing and watching more of my videos, whether they're new, old, whatever. Maybe even share one or two on social media, help spread the word. People who watch to the end of videos, like you, helps to tell the site, hey, this is a good video, we should recommend it to other people. So, if you made it this far, leave me a comment of something like, hey, I made it to the end. Love ya. See ya next time, family members. Bye.